I guess so. I'd like to call the meeting to order, 7:07 PM, Central Plymouth County Water District Commission. I'd like to pass around a sign-in sheet for everybody to... Sign in if you would.
Have you heard from Pat Plant whether he's coming or not?
I'm sorry, who? Patrick? No, well, he sent us an email this afternoon, so he's around, I think. Or, who knows? He said he was in the North Shore, he wasn't sure when he'd make it.
Oh, okay. So, there's your answer.
Yeah. Thank you, Frank.
My pleasure.
Okay, Paul, we have, may I have a copy of the agenda?
Okay.
I do have a meeting minutes.
Okay.
I didn't, I somehow left that behind, great. First order of business is to review the meeting minutes of August 22nd, 2016.
Through the honors.
Thank you.
So on August 22nd, we met at 7:00 in this very place, this probably very good. Anyway, first business on August 22nd was to review the August 3rd meeting minutes, and those were reviewed and approved by a 3-0 vote. The commission next discussed the best method for administering the $50,000 appropriated in fiscal year 2016, and that money is in the custody of Plymouth County. Two alternatives were discussed. The commission sets up its own bank account and its own employer identification number, and the county sends a $50,000 check to the commission bank account. The other alternative was the county maintains custody of the money, and the commission requests various expenditures as needed. After much discussion, it was decided to have the county maintain the custody of the funds, because the county is financially bonded, and they have administrative structure in place that would ease the burden on this voluntary commission. Next item of business was Bill Boulter from Pembroke gave the commission a report on the fish in Herring Brook and the effect of Brockton's water management on the fish. The fish in this case being herring. Next item that was discussed, Alex Mansfield of Jonesville Watershed Association gave a report to the commission on the effects of the drought on Silver Lake. Alex stated that the drought and Brockton's withdrawals have drained all the shallow areas of the lake, and the shoreline now is steeper and the lake will more likely drain faster. Lastly, the commission discussed the ongoing efforts to send a letter to the residents of Brockton via the Enterprise newspaper about the long-term water crisis facing Brockton. Commissioner Quinn said he would draft a very short message, 2 or 3 sentences, and add photos that make the point. Commission voted 3-0 to adjourn at 9 PM. That's it.
Thank you. It all jives with my recollection of the meeting, so I would entertain a motion to approve the minutes.
I'll make the motion to approve the minutes.
I guess I'll second, lacking anyone else. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposition, 2-0.
Okay, item number two, since Patrick isn't here yet, I'd like to table that towards the end of the meeting, since he may arrive with some things to discuss on that. This is a letter to the Brockton residents mentioned in the minutes. Three, discuss water withdrawals in the district. Boy, there's a broad topic there.
Yes. Yes.
Well, I guess to start off with, I know you're well aware of it, Paul and Pine and Alex are, but I have taken it upon myself, and I apologize for not checking with the commission, but I can tell you what, you can tell you why, to fire off a letter to Larry Rowley, the Public Works Commissioner in Brockton, stating in as many words that we were concerned that Brockton had been used, since Brockton had ceased using Aquaria, according to the latest water reports, and we're concerned about that, because it's, Aquaria is a desalination plant that's supposed to provide additional water supplies to Brockton and should be used to its fullest extent, and it helps Brockton, also reduces impact on its other reservoirs, which are showing a lot of stress due to many factors, not the least of which is the drought work. I did get a response email from Larry Rowley on September 2nd, and he copied a lot of politicians. I don't know if anyone on this is has a technical side to it, but basically said, he gave me some budgetary reasons why they were not using Aquaria to its fullest extent. Something along the lines of, while water rates are slated to rise, they're not rising very quickly, and it's going to take a while. And he thinks that, I don't know why he said this in the response, something about his Aquaria being established to provide a secondary water source and not to replace the use of Silver Lake. And he says that the need for a secondary source seemed to be necessary as the population grew at the time. However, with the city's implementation of certain water conservation measures and with the reduction in water users in recent years, the need has lessened. Mentioned that the city is conscious of the algae affecting Mon Ponce Pond. Mentioned some discussions with DEP. And then he assured me that the city does not divert when cells are above 70,000 cells per milliliter, and that the city abides by the legislation restricting diversions during the summer. And then he states that West Mon Ponce Pond is facing active algae blooms. Algae is not present, is his words, in either East Mon Ponce or Silver Lake. I have held off responding to that, even though I've got a lot of things to say pending our meeting and further guidance from the commission and anyone else that's interested. I mean, I take particular exception to the last paragraph, but the basic issue I have with the response is that, though I thought I made it pretty clear in my letter that it's not the algae cells that create the potential problem, it is the nutrients that are there year-round, that by diverting those to Silver Lake, it sets the stage for an algae bloom in Silver Lake, similar to Mon Ponce Pond, and by citing that 70,000 count and saying there's none in East Mon Ponce or Silver Lake, I fear it's just not being understood. And the other thing is that statement is factually incorrect. East Mon Ponce does have a algae count. I think the last DPH number I saw was 3,400 cells per milliliter.
It varies, but it's not zero. I'll wait on that information.
Yeah, it's not zero. And the other conceptual issue here is that the 70,000 is our state's set upper limit for recreational use. Has nothing to do with the water supply. And World Health Organization guidelines, which I always wave at everybody, recognizes that there's two separate standards. And the standard for starting to be concerned about a water supply is only 2,000 cells per milliliter. So I don't know what Silver Lake levels are. I don't even know if it's being tested, but I can see a hand up. So
well, I don't know that it's being tested either. I'd love to have them supply us the data that says there's none, because we don't have any data.
And that's point one in my letter. When I first say I'm not assured, or we are not assured, but it needs to be tested to know. Otherwise, it's a complete I doubt it's zero.
We asked them at one of our meetings, asked Brian, and I think it was Patrick, who was on the phone with him, and he said, we're testing the water as it comes out of the pipe from Mon Ponce Pond. And he said, no.
Oh, they're testing it in the plant.
In the plant.
I didn't know that they tested it in the plant.
Well, he once gave us a DEP report, because we questioned that back in like December of 2014 or something.
What I remember hearing quite a while ago was that the water sample was not only being taken from the plant, there was some spigot in the wall they were getting out of.
Yes.
And there was no, I'm in the environment.
The sink in the lab.
I'm in the environmental business, and we sample something. We have to sample it in a logical way, but also we have to prepare a chain of custody that says,
right.
Who
but they're
did
not
where
testing
it came
the lake,
from.
They're testing their water supply.
Right. Yeah, what they're testing may already be filtered by something. Mm-hmm. Treated. So it's, it seems, I mean, we can go on all night about how bizarre this is, but I think we need to make, on this, that, on the letter anyways, is I think we have to decide if we want to respond, and at least give me some, at least confirm my general outline of my response, so I can send something.
Okay, well, I mean, like you, I was not happy with the letter, and it's, to me, the same old story that Brockton's always been given. There's not a lot of variation. The only new thing in there is that Brockton Water Commission voted last October not to divert if the cell count was over the DPH threshold of 70,000 cells per million. Everything else in the letter is like standard stuff you get from Brockton all the time. You know, the fact that they had a water rate increase, well, it's not enough. You know, before they didn't have a water rate increase, it wasn't. They didn't have enough. So it's just, you know, it's the same old, same old. What I would recommend doing, instead of ping-ponging back and forth on emails, is to extend an invitation to him to appear before this commission and to talk about these issues. Because, as you pointed out, Jack, his communication was factually deficient. And I'm not even sure he knows some of the facts. I'm not sure Brian Creedon's telling him a lot of stuff.
Yeah, that's possible.
So I think it wouldn't do any harm to invite him here. Mm-hmm. This commission was invited to the city council, showed up, was barely recognized from what you told me, I was unable to attend. So we did our part in appearing in their forum. Maybe it's time for them to come to our forum. And that, a response like that saves a lot of back and forth. I mean, plus, how can you argue with an email like that? It's full of half-truths, no facts. You know, don't even waste your time.
Right, right. I you're right, and it's too easy to come across patronizing, but I guess as a technical person, I'm just very frustrated by just they don't seem to get the issue.
It's willful ignorance.
Okay, well,
they want to be ignorant.
But I would like to ask Larry, and you recall we've asked this to Brian before, do you have a professional engineer advising you on these matters?
Say you're CDM permit.
I would like to think somebody at CDM would understand this and be able to advise them appropriately. Well, that's a good suggestion, Paul. I'm glad, because I don't want to spend another hour or two writing a letter that's going to be that kind of response.
I mean, how do you respond to something that is, like I say, you know, half-truths, misunderstandings, and no facts? Recognizing Tom Coulter.
Tom, thank you for being here.
We're talking about an email that we got from Larry Rowley, Director of Brockton Public Works, in response to Jack O'Leary's email.
That's for you to keep, if you want.
That questioned why they'd stopped using the grader. And Larry responded, as I just said, as you came in, with a lot of half-truths, misunderstandings, and general facts. So I've suggested that instead of trying to respond to the stuff in his email, that we invite him here to the next meeting to discuss the issues with us so we can have a face-to-face. And as you probably know, this commission appeared before the Brockton City Council probably in July, I think.
June. I went to that.
Yeah, and Bailey was recognized by the City Council. But, you know, be that as it may, we'd invite him to our palatial townhouse here in Plymouth.
Oh, maybe Halifax.
Or Halifax. And you have more comfortable chairs. And have a discussion, you know, and talk about it. As I said to Jack just before he came, Larry may not know. Brian Creed may not be telling Larry all the relevant facts. You may not know.
Paul, I was at that meeting, I can tell you, and Pine was there as well, and so was Alex. I think you're 100% right. I think that the water commissioners are not, I think Brian's not telling the water commissioners what's going on. The water commissioners are not telling the city councilmen what are going on. And the city council and the mayor are completely in the dark.
Yep.
I would suggest that you, at the same time you invite him, you invite Pine and Alex, your contacts in the city council, the man and the woman. Farlow is a former mayor. And he's a very, very articulate, powerful member of that city council. And it was clear that he was completely in the dark that night.
One of the things that you missed, Paul, by being there, was Rob, there was a long prairie discussion at that city council meeting unrelated to our agenda item. It was about funding for their FY17 budget. And Larry Rowley was at the podium for that discussion, walking them through what they needed for funding. And one of the things he said was, the best thing for everybody would be if we took Aquarian all the time. So I think he may have an understanding of the value of that additional water supply, and that it's being driven by other things than just water management.
Yeah, that's promising. And so Tom, Larry did copy the mayor and other political office holders in Brockton, when I didn't, so he's, I wasn't sure what that meant. I deliberately did not copy anybody in a political office, and I was trying to keep it, you know, on a technical level, I hoped.
I wonder if Larry also forwarded to them your letter.
Oh, it's attached, yeah, they saw it, so they got it.
Well, that's great.
So they can't claim, they can't claim ignorance. I mean, they could, perhaps I could rewrite it and make it easier for them to understand, but I tried to.
I think yours was easier to understand than his response.
Thank you.
By far.
Sometimes I feel like with these things, you have to do show and tell, and here's a jar of water that's clean, and here's, yeah, here's one Ponset water, and here's what Silver Lake will look like in a year.
I don't want to be off-point at all, but I don't know if you guys received the invite on the follow-up for that meeting for this coming Monday. We were concerned that it would be another waste of time. We called Winthrop Farwell to ask him that, and he said it would be a waste of time, and that they were going to reach out to us to say don't come.
Oh, so do they send a written invitation?
Yeah, same address letter as
it
last
might be,
time.
I'll check on our mailbox at Halifax.
But we were tomorrow. Remember at that meeting they set the September meeting for us to come back because
I
they
do
would
recall that.
Have resolved the issues that prevented them from talking to us at that, but they haven't, and so I do see that invitation.
I'll check it out.
I was looking forward to getting that so I could send a letter back saying that we declined to attend.
We were the same, which is why we reached out to just say we would like to decline, but we don't want to just.
Yeah, you want to do the right thing, but you don't want to waste your time.
No, I would say we'd love to speak to you, but frankly, after our treatment at the last meeting, we don't have. We're not inclined to do so unless we're treated with some respect.
That was our point.
Okay, so do we need to have a motion on contacting Larry?
Could I get a motion on to ask the chair to request that Larry attend our next meeting?
Or a
future meeting.
I'll make that motion to invite Larry Rowley and other pertinent Brockton city officials to attend a future meeting of this commission.
I'll second that, and all in favor?
Aye.
Approved. Okay. That's a good suggestion. Okay. Are there other discussions on water withdrawals?
Well, I have a few things I want to talk about.
May I make one more point on that last issue?
Yeah.
And then I'll get off it. I think the more you invite a member of the city council, the mayor, even if they don't come, this is going to come down at the end of the day to them saying, we didn't know.
Yeah.
So the more you can invite them and they choose not to come and to make that a part of the record, I think it's very important.
Right. Yeah. Before we get too far, I appreciate you coming. If you want to have some, if you have to leave, feel free to speak up. And
no, I'm good. I'm sure you're listening tonight, believe it or not.
I was thinking actually that our next meeting, at least we ought to post it as a public meeting, would be your forum at the boat landing.
I'd love that.
I think all of us should be there.
I appreciate that. And if you would consider speaking at it, that would
love
be
to.
Helpful. Yep. We'll put you right in the agenda.
Okay.
Paul, you're out of town, right?
I am in Italia.
Huh. Tuscan.
When I grow up, I want to be you.
If I ever retire, I want to do what you do. Well, I am breaking an engagement to go there, but
we appreciate it.
Nothing as fun as Italy, just Marlboro.
Marlboro.
I'm vacationing at the Holiday Inn in Brockton next month.
Oh, wow. First prize 1 week, second prize 2 weeks.
That was good.
If you, but if you're well behaved, then let's.
I will remind you all that.
Oops. Sorry about that. I like that remark.
That was good.
Anyway. All right. Well, okay, Paul. I bet you have a lot to say. So the floor is yours.
Well, we have talked for some time, and most notably, Alex and Ponting have talked about the water quantity issue. And of course, talked about that way before this awful drought, which has only really highlighted it dramatically. And we've also talked in the past about inviting the DEP to come to one of these meetings and talk about the water quantity issues and the water withdrawals and the whole messy situation, which Jones River did a great presentation last November on for us about water registrations and about how they co-mingled. Well, Montponce Pond doesn't have a safe field, they just co-mingled it with Silver Lake. I think it's well within this commission's purview statutorily to have a discussion with the DEP about that and get their feelings on that and give them our feelings, which are that the way it's set up right now is wrong. I think, Alex, you said they called it flawed. So maybe that's a gentler term. But and I think to do that, to get them here, we probably need to have an afternoon meeting. I doubt we're going to get them to show up in the evening. But I would suggest that we have an after a 3 o'clock meeting, Halifax Town Hall here, whatever, and invite Millie, who's the regional director, Garcia Serrano, to come or send somebody like Dave Johnston or somebody like that to talk to us about water registrations. And then not only just the history of, you know, and what can be done about the checkered history of that, mm-hmm. between Silver Lake, Furnace Pond, and Montponce Pond, but then also kind of segue into, okay, what's going on now? You know, even without the drought, Brockton has decided that they're not going to use a quarry. They used it for 3 or 4 months.
You mean even with the drought?
And the drought makes it even more imperative that
they
use it.
Yeah.
I don't know what the motives were for Brockton to use a quarry as much as they did this year. I suspect they were trying to see if it would work consistently.
They're in a contract dispute.
Right.
And they were trying to prove that the Aquaria is out of contract compliance. Right. And they were trying to run it at a max to see if it was sustainable.
Right, yeah. And so we could talk about that, their occasional use of Aquaria and how it needs to be every day, in my opinion anyway. And also talk about, has the DEP seriously investigated other issues, such as MWRA? And I know that people will bring up, oh, well, we're under contract to the company that owns Aquaria and everything. And, you know, this is true, and contracts are hard to get out of. But investigating and planning for MWRA membership is a long-term thing, and it's not too soon to start. Contract with Aquaria's got 10 years left to run. I know that sounds like a long time, but it's not in the government world, particularly with if there's going to, first, as the Aquaria people said to Tom and I at the State House meeting in June, they're not going to entertain anything until the political will is demonstrated by the local community. They're not even going to go to a meeting, because they've been down this road with Brockton before in the late 90s.
MWRA.
So, so that takes time, generating that political will. All the politics and broadening that involves. And then even if you had agreement, getting the necessary infrastructure in place would take a few years. So that's why I say it's not too soon. If they ever get agreement on doing MWRA, it's not too soon to start that process.
Really, well, we are filing legislation the first week of January to require them to go on MWRA. And as you know, work in the building, that is a long process, particularly when the Brockton legislative delegation will be working to kill it.
Right.
But at least that'll be the stick that will get their attention.
Yeah. And then this drug certainly puts more than one exclamation point on all of these issues in terms of water withdrawals from the natural sources that have been traditionally used in this region. So I think those are, you know, that's a broad, broad agenda to discuss. And I would say that if in fact DEP is willing to come, that that's the only agenda item that we discuss, because it's so much depth and breadth to it. And so that, I want your comments, what your thoughts are on that.
Well, I think it's a good idea in general, but as you know, I'm not a, you're no kidding about 10 years is not a long time with the state. I'm apparently either very impatient or I work at a normal pace. I can't tell which. And I'd like to think, how can we turn a meeting with the DEP into an action item that gets something done?
Well, I think one way is, and we'll discuss this tonight, is to pick some things that we want to get out of that. What do we want to get out of that meeting as a Central Plymouth County Water District Commission? And you know, let's discuss that. I agree, you're not going to get any kind of decision or agreement on Brockton going on the MWRA.
Right.
Because it's such a huge topic. But I'd broach it, but I wouldn't devote the whole meeting to it. But I'd definitely broach it.
Well, I guess I'm thinking of things like some kind of an enforcement process that starts, because if there was an industrial plant sitting on a Wauponset pond that pumped out a pollutant that turned the water green, there's no doubt the DEP would be on top of it like that.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Why is there no enforcement?
Well,
there
is a parallel process going on that was initiated by Wauponset Water Association with the help of Representative Coulter and other members of the legislative delegation in the town of Halifax. And DEP was working towards an administrative consent order with Brockton, which would include using the query on a regular basis.
But hasn't, I mean, Pine, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't, you have an encyclopedic knowledge of this, but isn't the query the result of a consent order from years ago? Mm-hmm. Wasn't the intent of that consent order to have Brockton use it all the time to reduce stress on other?
In our interpretation of it, yep.
Well, that's the kind of, that's the kind of thing I would like to press the DEP on when we meet with them.
Yeah, I agree. Absolutely agree with
this. I want them to sweat a little bit. It's their job. You know, do your job. It's their job to enforce these things and to be protecting the environment. I'm flabbergasted that we've gone on this long without enforcement on it. It's, when a pond like Wauponset Pond can't be used for recreation all summer, and we have all these studies of the health effects of the algae that's being created, I would think that'd be a priority for them.
At the risk, if I may apply it, at the risk of talking out of school, I'm going to be a little bit careful here. Mm-hmm. The 1,000-person petition that was submitted to the governor and to the Secretary of the Environment has had a profound impact on a sense of urgency at DEP.
Good.
And I think we will get some notice very soon that they want to meet with your commission. The only thing I will say that I've been briefed on is negotiation on the consent order turned very quickly when they got some recent data back from negotiation to a order.
Which data is that, Tom?
Paul, what's the
other? That's the TMDL. Total maximum daily load.
That data, combined with the citizens rising up on this cause, have made this a priority for DEP that it's never been in the past.
That's good.
Now, they're struggling because their staff has been reduced again. That building is like a ghost town.
Oh, yeah.
Over in Lakeville.
Yeah.
But they've assigned new counsel to it, who's been involved in spearheading the discussion with Brockton. I know it's been very heated. He was in the room with us that day.
Oh, not Bob Brown, it was a previous guy.
I know. I've got the notes in my office.
I have a different notebook. Sorry.
But he had just been reassigned to it.
He had come from Boston, I think.
Right.
Boston office.
And I can tell you from personal discussions with Secretary Beaton and Governor Baker, this is a top priority for DEP now. It has never been. It is now. Your work, the petition, has made this center stage.
Well, that's good. Is Governor Baker going to line item veto our budget again, or whatever that process is?
9C reduction.
9C reduction?
Who knows?
He will not. No.
I was going to say, I appreciate it, but I
didn't veto it this time. It's the first year he hasn't vetoed it.
Yep. He won't, he knows it's a crisis.
Oh, he didn't veto it this, this summer?
No.
I'm pleasantly surprised.
We're in good shape.
We can actually try to preempt that by requesting the money from DCR.
Right.
What might not be a bad idea if you're so inclined.
That's a great idea.
So let's cut right to the money, and let's make a motion on that.
Well, let's just step back for a second. How about if DP really is this willing, I'm loving what I'm hearing here. Pardon me for being skeptical, because I'm very suspicious, but maybe it would make it easier if we actually asked DP if we could actually hold our meeting in their offices in Lakewood. And that way, people who might otherwise not attend would be able to be there. Pine, you have a comment to that?
Yeah, you should know that the Water Management Act has held that up.
Boston. Okay, well, maybe we should do it in Boston.
We should do it in Boston. Lakeville is a waste of time.
Maybe we should do it at the State House.
That'd be good.
It's right around the corner. Winter Street.
But there's something symbolic about being called in there.
Yes.
To respond.
Certainly is.
Well, I'm open to suggestions from people more politically astute than I am, which includes just about everybody, so.
And I'll brief you on the rest of it another time.
Okay, so you could arrange for a State House meeting?
Oh, of course, yes.
Okay, so you have an Andy calendar there on the computer?
I do, yeah.
That's another big empty building this time of year.
That's right, technically you're a man of leisure right now, even though you're probably never were.
I was about to say, I'm not leisure.
He's here tonight.
Yeah, my appointment was at Halifax Court, Selectman was at 9 o'clock.
Well, you're also running for office, which means you're basically, if there's not an hour during the day, you have to do something. Let's see, we
usually do it the 4th of October.
Yeah, which would be the 24th of October. Which is, fortunately, there is no Monday night football game of interest in that. We are missing Red Sox game. Cable TV, I don't have cable, so I'm stuck with the app.
You don't have cable?
I'm online.
That was going to be on cable.
I have a Roku TV. What's going on?
You got Roku. Are you not?
I have the whole internet. You guys are all going to be able to do that. More stuff than I dreamed of, internet TV. Plus, I have an old thing in my attic where I can get most pretty space and digital quality from Providence, Rhode Island. Why not? I paid nothing for it, any of it.
Good.
Well, I bought the TV.
I was going to go to the house and see the rabbit.
Yeah. Oh, no.
The tin foil.
Yeah. No, the antenna's so big it goes from that podium all the way to this wall. You should have seen me shoving it through the hatch for the app. I live in fear of lightning strikes, I'll grant you that.
Yeah.
I think I'm okay.
It's grounded
pretty well.
So, Tom, is Monday okay for State House meeting?
Anytime. You pick the day.
So, Monday.
Monday, 24th. We'll speak about the meeting.
September 24th?
October 24th.
October 24th. Get out at 5. We're in the middle of rush hour. I don't know.
I'll take the train.
I was going to say, was there a cheap place to park there?
Yeah, at the State House. I'll get parking papers.
Nice, okay.
I'll take the train. You may get me parked next.
I'll drive you in. Yeah,
then we have to sit there and rush out traffic and sit in the train.
If there are two of you, you can take the...
Oh, the zipper. Yeah. Okay, I'll go with you.
See, we get Patrick along, too. See, if he's not making a movie.
He's not making a movie.
If he's not, yeah. Okay.
So let's make a motion here.
I'd like a motion to schedule our not our next, but our subsequent meeting to be Monday, October 24th, 3 p.m. at the Massachusetts State House, room to be arranged.
Is 3 p.m. good, or do you want to 3 p.m. right?
You know, it doesn't matter to me, but anyone have any
thoughts? What do you think works, Tom?
The building is wide open, so it's really...
It's really traffic driven.
It's up to you.
It's a question of coming home.
Yeah, you'll definitely
be meeting means you're in traffic coming home.
Yeah, there's always traffic in Boston. Yeah, that would definitely be bad.
It starts at 2.
Yeah, there's no way around. I've come home through Boston at 11 o'clock at night and we had traffic on the Southeast Express.
Say 3 p.m. Say 3 p.m.
No. Carbon footprint's too high.
On the train?
I'm just trying to get you started, I'm sorry.
I'm running all the time, dude.
All right, so I'll make a motion that this commission invite the DEP to meet at the invitation of it's the invitation of this commission through the agency of Representative Call to get a room in the State House to meet on October 24th at 3 p.m. to discuss water withdrawals as relates to the three major bodies of water that are mentioned in the 1964 Act, which is Silver Lake, Mount Pontchartrain, and Burns Pond. So, there's a motion.
Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Tom, or Pine, if you have an opinion too, you're both welcome to jump in. The only purpose of having a meeting at the State House is to meet with important people at the DEP. I don't know what, I'm assuming if they make a commitment, they could make a commitment this far ahead, they could stick to it, is that a reasonable assumption?
If they make a commitment to be at a meeting at the State House, they'll be there.
Okay.
So, what, do you want me to invite Secretary Beaton and the Commissioner of DEP?
I would. Invite them anyway, they may send a designee.
Yeah. Great. Thank you.
I like that.
So, Tom, should I send the notice and the recording, the invitation, or should we, Jack, actually? Should we send it to the same parties?
Yes.
Yeah, please. So, they'll hear from us and from you.
That's great.
So, Secretary Beaton and Martin's super.
And also Senator Brady.
And Senator Brady. I'll get you all the.
If you would, yeah, I don't have the second guy doesn't ring a bell, so thank you.
I just want to let you know that we are meeting. We, Alex and I, are meeting with Commissioner Suberg tomorrow. At noon with Dwayne Levangian, who is the head of the Water Management Act program for DEP. Dwayne is a Whitman resident.
Really?
Lifelong. So it's possible that you could ask him to one of these meetings too, because he was around the corner.
Yeah, sure.
But he runs the program, and we also, I think Bethany Carr is planning to be there too. What position she has, no, this is just our meeting tomorrow.
Yeah.
So, I mean, our intention has been to basically, do the same thing as you're talking about tonight. But because, I happened to run into the commissioner last week at a drought management task force meeting, so that's how the meeting happens, because I've been hounding him for over a year about it. But our intention is to talk to him about Silver Lake and the level and the registrations. So we'll prime the pump?
Yeah.
So it's not brand new, to any of those people. We don't have any lawyers there in the room, which we probably will, unfortunately. But, my whole...
That won't take offense.
With DEP lawyers, it's like what happened with the city solicitor in Brockton. They just kind of shut everything down.
Yeah.
My personal hope is that we get them to the point where the commissioner understands that there is no way that if the registrations were ever valid, they cannot be followed now because of the condition of Mount Pontchartrain and a precipitous decline. I don't know that Alex is thinking from here.
You can have a look at these if you're interested.
Sure.
It's the same charts you've seen Brian Green send around, but I added this year on it, which he does the plot this year as we go. So the important part there is just that we are.
I'm taking this is what you're putting.
No, that's 2002. The red is current. And so we're in the second worst since 2002. But if you look back at January 2002, the real story of 2002 was where it came out of in 2001.
Right.
And we started worse than that this year. And so I anticipate that 2017 is going to be the worst year that we've seen in 25, 20 years at least, or 30 years. But the most important thing, I think, that we want to convey to DEP when we talk to them tomorrow about this, is that if you look at pretty much every one of those lines, every year, in October, the Monpont's diversion gets turned on, and the trend starts going back up. And that's the only thing that is keeping Silver Lake recovering. And that is not going to happen. I think we can all agree that that is most likely not going to happen.
For two reasons. One is the algae.
Right.
And two is, as of yesterday, Monpont's, it was 20 inches below.
Which is huge for Monpont's.
Not going to come back anymore.
Alex, not being a technical person, I understand that.
Right.
So that is a great argument.
Good. Well, so, and so cutting.
It's the first thing you've ever said, I think.
And so getting to the point of that is that in all the previous years since the 60s, the Monpont's diversion has come on in October and helped seemingly recover to some extent. That is not going to happen this year. Jack, you said in your introduction, the least of our problem, you know, the drought is, the least of which is the drought. I would argue that the drought is the least of our problems. It's the water management problems that overshadow.
Right.
This happens every year regardless.
Yeah, that's a good chart demonstrating that.
But to take that point a little bit further that we're trying to convey to the commissioner tomorrow is the registrations. Because if the registrations were correct, where Monpont had an allocation of the supply, Silver Lake had an allocation of the supply, and Furnace Pond had the allocation of the supply. Come October, when you can't turn on that Monpont's diversion, it would be very easy for DEP to say, this portion of your registration is unavailable to you because of water quality, therefore, you can only take X from Silver Lake, and you need to find another source for the rest. Aquarium, whatever, emergency to end the door,
or
whatever,
reduce your consumption.
And so DEP, in defense to some extent, is working under this flawed registration where they don't have the teeth to parse out those pieces, and the registration is commingled. They have a difficulty in saying you can't keep taking from Silver Lake. They have a hard time saying that because it's registered. So that's the point we want to get across to them.
If you're able to make that point to them, and I've heard DEP in our meetings talk about how frustrated they are with the registrations and how it's a bound of spaghetti for them. They can't unbundle it. But if you're right, and I'm sure you are, about the impact on 2017, then part of our argument and legislation should be to require them to hook up temporarily to MWRE, because that's a 2 to 3 week process.
Yep.
And if you're right, and this happens in 2017, you can't shut down a major city.
Talking about from Stoughton?
Yes, shut down a major city for 2 or 3 weeks, but that's what will happen. So it would be in Brockton's best interest for DEP to require and for the legislation to dictate that they hook up, if not permanently, temporarily.
Do you know how much water they can get through Stoughton?
Unlimited.
I thought the pipe size was...
Oh, you were talking about distribution-wise,
the pipeline.
I'm talking about the quantity of water. I don't know.
I don't know what the infrastructure issues are. I don't know.
Thank you, Tom. Yeah, that's a good point. Bill, you've been patiently trying to ask a question. Go right ahead.
Yeah. Bill Boulter, I'm the Selectman.
Bill, you got to know when it's snuck out of the
back. Yeah, and I'm also in the fisheries. We have a really bad problem in Furnace Pond right now because it's so low. It's probably down, it looks like it's down probably 2.5-3 feet, from the normal. Now, the last couple of years, we've been saving more than we said at the last one. And again, this year, we were saving water to hold so that we could have migration for the fish in the fall. Unfortunately, there is no water in the streams at all, very, very little. Boulter Pond is down so low right now that there's very, very a trickle going between Oldham and Furnace Pond, which is not enough for the juvenile fish to get through. And what's really sad about this whole thing is that we've worked so hard to get, the fish up to coming back.
And you've been
this moratorium.
You've succeeded.
And we succeeded. that this is the biggest year that we've had.
Yep.
You know, with over 238,000 fish that were counted coming up this year, and we have no way of getting them down.
Yeah, they're gonna get pulled into Silver Lake when they do a diversion.
Yeah, so we have a meeting tomorrow night with the fisheries, and that's gonna be one of the topics that we're gonna talk about, is that...
With marine fisheries, I'm sorry.
The diversion, they can divert October 1st, and if they're gonna divert more water on October 1st, it's...
If it continues to stay down, they won't be able to, because Furnace, like Mon Ponset, has a threshold.
Right.
So if it's below that threshold...
So Brian, the report I got from yesterday, from Brian, said almost 12 inches, the level that they're allowed to do. And what Brian has told this commission is that it takes an inch, the lakes rise, you get an inch of rain, the lakes rise 2 inches. So you would need about 6 or 7 inches of rain just to get to the level they could start to do in October. So barring a major tropical storm, you're not going to get that much rain.
And you know, of course, that what Brian says is absolutely true.
Well, that's all we have to go on.
And I think one of the things we're going to address in the letter and send to Brockman is the fact that when we can start to divert, they're going to divert, but in the meantime, we have all these juveniles that, you know, they're going to be trying to get out. And they still haven't repaired the screen down there.
Yeah.
So as soon as they open up anything to divert anything, these juvenile fish are going right down.
Right.
Last year, some of the guys took it upon themselves to go out and buy a net, because we had asked Brockton time and time again that, you know, we need to repair this. And they didn't do anything, and I think some of the legislators came down and saw all the juvenile fish there, you know, that were hanging around the diversion pipe. And so we put a net across there last year to stop any of the juveniles from getting in that area, so they wouldn't get diverted into Silver Lake. But, I mean, what a shame to have to do all this work for the last 3 or 4 years and finally get things, you know, starting to build up, and then you don't have enough water, to get them down. So
it is a shame, and it's a...
Did they stop diverting in May? Am I correct to think that they didn't divert after May?
Yeah, they stopped. Yep, they stopped around May 16th, something like that.
Yeah, I don't know where the water went then, because we put in extra boards and we raised the gate down there so that...
Don't people water in their lawn?
Oh no, wait a minute. I take that back. I'm sorry. They stopped diverting from Mon Ponset Pond in May.
Right.
They stopped.
No, they stopped Furnace also.
In May?
May 18th.
Okay.
May 18th?
Yep.
Oh, okay. So it wasn't May 1st. It was probably halfway through.
Well, they like to talk about it. They like to talk about
it. It was off for the first week of May.
See, one of the things is too is that we don't know what that is. We have no idea what that is. That when they convert.
Well, Bill, may I jump in? I just want to observe that it sounds like very familiar to me, because I can recall Halifax officials having issues with diversions right after algae treatments were added to Mon Ponset Pond. The lack of coordination.
Right.
2013.
I think that's a subject that we ought to bring up with Larry Rowley, if we can get him here in the meeting. Is to talk to him, maybe. Maybe there'll be communications that will be remembered so we can start having contacts that make sense, so things make sense.
Right. We don't begrudge them from having the water, as long as we have water in excess. We give them all the water they want, and we have excess. We're supposed to have 300,000 gallons a day going down over the dam.
Right.
And that hasn't happened for quite a while, sometime in May, because they sucked it down so low.
Right, right.
And maybe they have a right to do that, but that's just a shame for them taking it down that low.
Right. So that gets back to their water management practices, whether it's in the Furnace Pond example, in Mon Ponset Pond, it's something else. It's the overall water management practices in the Rockland Water Department that need to examine, which is why this commission wants to hire a consultant to start looking at. You mentioned that you wanted to get some measurements, and Jack does too, on the dam levels and things like that. So
I'm trying to, but it's surveyors are incredibly busy right now, so it's tough to get their attention, but...
But that, you know, that would be a start, to start getting information about what they're doing, when they're doing, and why they're doing it.
Yeah, I think Weymouth Fisheries, if I'm correct in saying that, they have a device that they put in their river down there, so they know even when someone's walking through it. I mean, they can tell when the water's, how it's running and where it's going or whatever, and it's probably we need to look into something like that, because we have no idea when they're diverting, and they've always been good by saying, you know, can you tell us when you're diverting and when, how much you've diverted, and they'll send you a list. They'll send you a whole list of days that they have and how much they diverted, but even the, when the Division of Marine Fisheries biologists went down there and talked to them, which I don't think they knew, they have four different levels that they can draw water on by opening the valve. Level one, level two, level three, level four. They were on level one when the biologist came and did a study on it and said, oh, well, the water is not running fast enough for the fish to hear the water running and, you know, a fast, making a lot of noise and all that because they're attracted to the noise. So we don't even think that they would go near the diversion pipe.
Yeah.
Well, we found that to be wrong because we went over there and watched the juvenile right in. You know, they were going right in there. So that's when we went and got the net and put the net across there. But that was only on level one. So if they crank it up to level three or four or something, they can do a lot of diverting in the middle of the night or anytime they want.
Oh, yeah. And
we have no idea when they're doing that.
You know, so. Well, it just goes back to the same thing. Lack of coordination and information. Now I gotta go fishing over at Furnace Pond so I can catch fish with the ears.
Jeff, can I ask a question? I have to run soon. I've been wondering about this. If they can't divert, if Brockton can't divert in October because of the cyanobacteria, and that body of water remains stagnant, will the cyanobacteria automatically drop, or does it need flow in order to drop, or treatment?
No, the other way around.
Tell me what
will happen. The more stagnant it is, the worse it will get.
Yeah, if they don't divert
and it remains stagnant,
Stump Brook Dam is in the right shape. There's going to be some flow to the west. When Brockton diverts, it reverses that flow. So even if Stump Brook Dam is operating correctly, it potentially stagnates the water even during a diversion.
Even during diversion.
See, right now, it's the water's so low because of the drought. You go out the Stump Brook Dam.
It's going to be.
Oh, well, right now. On the other side, on the upstream side of the dam, there's water.
Right.
But because the sluice gate is shut, the water's so low. Sluice gate's lower, fish ladder gate's a little higher, and fish ladder gate's been dry for months. Sluice gate is closed, and so there is a little water backing up. On the downstream side, going to Robbins Pond, East Bridgewater, it's all mud.
Yep. So if they can't divert, what will happen to the levels of cyanobacteria?
They will increase.
Because as long as it's hot, they will.
For two reasons. As long as the weather stays hot, as long as the water stays stagnant, which it will, because he hasn't opened the sluice gate. Granted, there wouldn't be a tremendous flow because the water levels are so low, but it's better than nothing. If you open the sluice gate, it might help, but that's been closed for some time. And the other thing is, and I learned this from Mark Madsen from DEP when he gave a presentation about TMDL on September 1st at Halifax Town Hall. Blue green algae wants to be on the surface and get the sunlight. So if the pond's so low now, even if you used alum to bring it down, there's not much depth left to the pond. I mean, people are complaining that, you know, can't barely use your motorboat. You've got to be really careful.
So will Westmont Ponset remain unavailable to Brockton?
For two reasons. One is the reason we talked about, the blue green algae. And Brockton's Water Commission voted in October of last year not to divert in those circumstances, if it's above DPH level.
For recreational use, too, by the way.
True. And secondly, it's too low under the 1964 statute to divert. So those are the two reasons. There's no way that they're diverting in October from so, the furnace or Montmont.
So that could, to your point, Alex, about it being worse than ever, that we're back to the quantity problem. There could be a serious
in Silver Lake and quality problem in Montmont.
And so
it's double in Montmont because it's not at the statutory level.
Right.
So
So it's got a bad water, quality and low water in Mon Ponce.
So is it fair to say that Brockton residents, is it an overstatement to say that Brockton residents are mostly unaware of the crises, the looming crises they have with respect to water quantity?
I would say that not just the residents, but the officials.
And that's despite your best efforts.
Right.
In the press to alert them to it, and we saw the Water Commission's response was just in denial.
The thing that you have to keep in mind is that in 1964, or in the early 1960s, there was a drought. It sucked Silver Lake down low enough that there was an emergency that the legislature decided that it was acceptable to divert Mon Ponce
as a
supplement. Mont Ponce, due to its current water quality, could be off the table,
right,
which puts us right back to pre-1964. So we essentially, due to the water quality problem of Mont Ponce, just took a 50-year step back in time in terms of water supply.
Well said. That sums it up.
He's not available for the forum.
Sorry.
And Silver Lake is water quality is worsening too. As a result of all of the diversions and responses into it.
Sure.
So the lower Silver Lake becomes, the more likely you're going to start to see that. I have seen blueberry algae blooms in Silver Lake. Not this year. I haven't gone out and done any testing or anything. But there are cells there, and so.
Oh yeah.
So if you concentrate that, you're creating.
Well, as you know, it's the nutrients that get things started. And but the Mon Ponce diversions, even when the algae count for Mon Ponce is lower than 70,000, brings all the nutrients that are in Mon Ponce.
A study that was done on Silver Lake that said a third of the phosphorus comes from Mon Ponce pond.
Right.
In Silver Lake.
Yep.
And if there were a TMDL for Silver Lake, that diversion would be up points in terms of, because that would be the big point source contribution.
Right.
There was an MPDES permit.
If there was a permit.
Right.
You'll have to excuse me.
Tom, thank you very much for coming.
Sorry.
Okay. I've been in Silver Lake lately. The macroalgae's increasing every year, and that's feeding out the same nutrients that macroalgae takes off. Climate's unpredictable. We don't know when we might have a warm winter.
Just to give you, for instance, I checked today. We're down at Silver Lake, according to Brian's report.
4.5 feet.
Yeah, 55 inches. Yeah. This time last year, it was 45 inches.
This is Mon Ponce or Silver Lake?
Silver Lake, yeah. And
the reason I mention that is that last year, Silver Lake got very low, so that November, its low point was 65 inches below what the law considers full. We're going to surpass that this year. Right? We're already at 55 inches.
Yeah, just in the last week. Yeah. I checked the shoreline up just the last week.
You can see it. I mean, it's dropping an inch a day now, as Alex predicted at our last meeting.
Yeah.
So, there's no stopping it between the weather and Brockton's withdrawals. That's not
there. We don't know when Jones River is going to see any water from it because of this. I mean, it could be another year or more.
Jones River is at its lowest flow since about the middle of August. It's at its lowest flow that it has been at since they put the gauge in 1967.
That's the USGS gauge?
Yeah. Lowest flow.
Well, okay. It certainly.
And we have fish to get out, from other places in the river too, and it's just not going to happen because we still have that dam there.
Right.
Getting them by the dam is going to be hard, just like it is over the Furnace.
Well, that's what I was saying to Brad Chase from Division of Marine Fisheries last week, and he said that we're just going to have to be patient and hope that we're going to get some water before Thanksgiving.
They're not really predicting. They're certainly not predicting anything until October, and the weather, the winter theoretically is going to be sort of mild.
If they can predict climate at all, I mean, yes, it's none of the predictions.
Their own evaluation in the Taunton Weather Office is
24 hours before a weather event, they were 50-50, record being correct, so.
Yeah, we've had a lot of non-productive storms. We just had that little.
That's called timing.
Tiny shower, but yeah, no, it's, I mean, the La Nina that usually falls El Nino really hasn't started, and that's.
Well, they're suggesting that there won't be either this year.
Yeah, so that throws everything up on you.
Bill? So I just have a question, whether you got that letter from the Board of Selectmen from Pembroke?
Yes.
Stating our interest.
We got it, thank you.
And also, there was one that was supposed to be coming from Conservation.
I have that as well.
Did you get that too?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You can share that with Patrick and I'll scan it. Okay, well, are we done with the water withdrawals? We're gonna have a meeting at the State House with the DEP to explore this. And yes, thank you for priming the pump. Tomorrow, your meeting, find out, will help. Yeah, thank you very much. Next item is finalized business cards and letterhead.
Okay, well.
Did you see the email from Patrick?
I did. Patrick got an email or letter from Secretary of State's office.
It was an email.
Contacted them because under, I think it's Chapter 6 of General Laws, they determine who can use the state seal, probably the mass seal. And he heard from a Laurie Sullivan staff attorney at Secretary of State's office. And just to sum it up, she said, the commission members are neither state government office nor state government agency. So, we struck out being a county agency. We struck out being a state agency. We're having an addendum crisis here.
Well, I spoke to the governor of Maine, and he said he's more than happy. Frankly, like this, he's more than happy to let us use their seal.
Perfect.
And also to bring Plymouth County, but only Plymouth County, back, join it with Maine. The rest of the state can go to, I don't want to say, you know how blunt he is.
Yeah.
Don't go there. But he likes Plymouth County, so, but seriously, I guess, well, do I have permission to go on a ranch, or should we just
hold off that? Let me just make what I hope is a rational suggestion. So, because of nobody really wants to weigh in on what we are, even though no one's denying we're in the statute, I think we're free to do our own.
Oh, yeah.
Letterhead and do our own design.
Frank, I was hoping you had already printed it up with the state seal to beat this, because I don't think we've.
I can check to make sure that order, it might have gone through.
I mean, frankly, what are they going to do about it?
Well, we've been notified, so as an attorney myself, I don't want to go down that road.
Well, I'm a sovereign citizen.
It's sovereign citizen.
It's my logo, as each one of us, the logo belongs to us.
Well, I agree with that. We're
just because some low-level attorney in the Secretary of State's office says something, and all due respect to attorneys, but you know the old saw. Ask two attorneys, you'll get three different opinions.
Well, she's got specific regulations cited in the letter, so. Anyway, well.
We can modify it ever so slightly.
That's what I'm saying, yeah, we'll just modify it. We'll tweak it.
Accept the law.
Close to my heart, we'll put an assault rifle in the Indians here.
Yeah, okay, so, you and.
Put a straw in there.
In my absence, while I'm in Italy, you and Patrick can come up with a design, and we can approve it, you know.
Well, Patrick since Patrick made the contact, I'm going to ask him to.
Yeah.
I'm kind of.
I mean, if you want, when I'm in Florence, I'll look at some artistry and try to get inspired. You know.
Think about that, Pine. How much better off would the continent be if the European visitors were greeted with Native Americans who had AR-15s? So go to a tribal conference in Sioux Nation and have a chat about their history, and it's very eye-opening. I used to live out there.
Okay.
I see, it is a question, what do you guys think about the immigration debate? And, they're looking at me like, do you even have to ask?
So is this your rant or your answer?
My rant's these are actually jokes, okay, at least in my world. Anyway, I'm a little frustrated, but it is what it is, and let's get a logo. Let's get something together so we look professional. We issue written communications to people.
So, the only thing we didn't touch was discussing the ongoing letter discussions with the residents. And Patrick's not here. He's the one who's going to get some photos together and put together a couple of sentences.
Yep.
So we're going to have to table that yet again, although I think
having Larry Rowley at probably a November meeting, may dovetail, if we can get him to show up, may dovetail with that whole issue.
Yep, that sounds fine. I mean, I'd like to be a little more aggressive about it, but it seems like...
Well, when we met last time, they were using Aquaria, and they had done a water, outdoor watering ban or restriction. So we were kind of like, well, the landscape, the things we're going to talk about had changed. But then they stopped using Aquaria after our meeting. So now we're back to, okay, they have a little, of the four things we're going to talk, tell them about, they've done one, which is the water restriction, but there are many other things that they need to be aware of. So, do you have any other stuff you want to talk about, or?
No, I just, I mean, we scheduled a couple of meetings, but I...
Let me just review those, so I make sure I get them right.
Yeah, my comment is just generally, I think, we didn't involve Patrick in scheduling them, but I think going forward, we really need him to make these meetings, and we have to figure, ask him, how are we going to make that happen? Because you and I are able to do it usually, and...
Yeah, even if he calls in.
Yeah.
So, I've got us down as, I'm going to send a public meeting notice for this commission for September 24th.
Yep.
Location, state boat ramp off Route 58 in Halifax. And the topic would be the water quality issues in Monpont Pond.
Mm-hmm.
And probably, I'm not going to put this on the agenda, but I'm sure people will address it as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, and that meeting, I have it on my computer, the meeting time. Mm-hmm. But Bill needs
it's to know.
It's 10 a.m.
10 a.m.
So September 24th at 10 a.m.
Okay.
That's one meeting.
Yes, you want to see how voice recognition changes that meetings? The last one there.
Oh, man. Incredible. So then the meeting after that will be October 24th, 3 p.m. That's a Monday.
Yep.
At the State House. Before I send that notice out, I'll get the room number. It's probably where we met before, but I'll find out from Tom.
I'll set it up by 8:00.
Yeah, and so I'll get that out. And those are the two meetings we agreed to.
Mm-hmm.
Great. All right. So
So I need to contact, invite Larry Rowley to our November meeting.
To a November meeting.
Does it make any sense just to see if he's available for the October meeting at the State House? Would he be interested in being part of that, do you think? Or would we want him there?
I want to talk to the state officials.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I talked to Brockton enough, and that's why I said...
Tone is suggesting inviting Senator Brady already.
So yes, right. They have a representation there, and... they tend to, especially Brian's, it tends to obfuscate things.
You should invite Josh Tuller from the Pembroke, he's a state representative. He's very interested in this.
I'm sure we will. If you've seen any of my meeting notices, they're always on notice of the meeting, so yes.
And you were going to get me contact info for Secretary Beaton, the other gentleman?
Secretary Beaton and Commissioner Suberg, and I'll get that to you ASAP since we're going next week.
And the location of the 24th of September?
State House. When you get the notice.
No, so that's the boat ramp on Route 58 on Ponce Pond. Okay. That's Tom Coulter's meeting, and that's just, we're just being there to, because
questions you'll get that below. Notice, Bill, as okay. The same as Pine does and Alex does. It's the same procedure that they do. And Frank as well.
You had talked about securing monies that may be taken back.
Yeah, yes.
Did you?
Oh, that's right. We were going to vote. Thank you for
that.
Thank you. Yeah. Somebody's paying attention.
Okay. Yeah.
And then so other point. Yeah. 2 points. As Bill said, there's a fisheries and wildlife, and one of the directors has very inexpensive buoys. It's racing Radio Shack stuff today compared to what it used to be. Price-wise.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see any reason why there hasn't been an effort to install these, so it's not if and when or what. They know the temperature, the flow, the height, automatically from a computer. Nobody has to tell them or ask them. They just punch it up, It's real time. They can tell if there's somebody splashing around, a human or an otter, in the, it's that technical. They're not that expensive, he said, and I think it would behoove everybody to have real-time information, and then on these algae studies, you have a budget. Why don't you get your own independent people to test so you can quantify, at least have an argument that is quantifiable. I mean, when you go to the steakhouse sometimes, I mean, otherwise it's all figures that are just smoke and mirrors, you know?
No, you're all good points.
And you need to take and address the issues yourselves with X amount of finances you have available. I would leave it at that.
All good points that our finances were constantly under a cloud of uncertainty until basically last month. And we've been talking to consultants about some of these things. And first order of business is to get some precise elevations and all the items, all the markers, so we can check things against the state, the legislation's requirements.
Yep.
We have all this data that we just don't know.
If you had these buoys, when you got that datum, it would be information you could apply to it automatically.
So yeah. Well,
in my opinion, there's no reason for not having this type of technology.
Oh yeah, well, we're going to be engaging presumably scientific and engineering consultants. We'll ask them what the appropriate equipment is, and something like that probably would be in the mix. But we get a lot of work to do, and we only just now we have access to our funds, so we are.
But collecting facts that you know are your facts would give you, in my opinion, maybe a strong case.
That's what we're striving for. Absolutely, yep.
So I'll make a motion that we ask the Plymouth County Treasurer's Office to request a transfer of the $50,000 that's appropriated in item 2810-0100 of the state budget, fiscal 2017 budget. It's an allocation for the Central Plymouth County Water District Commission for the improvement of lakes and ponds in the district, and that they request that money be transferred to the custody of the Plymouth County Treasurer.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Frank.
We'll get on that tomorrow.
I appreciate it.
Frank, you have a question?
Just one quick question. Just want to make sure you gentlemen received the email about the email
access. Yes, I did. Yeah.
And if you had any problems,
I did update it after I got that from
you. Okay, good.
So that worked. I haven't actually accessed.
I haven't tried it yet, but I'll try and get on it before I go away.
Right.
It works in Italy too, I'm sure.
No, not on my device.
Gmail. There are vacation, so you can send
out of office. Yeah, I find that helpful.
So it's full Microsoft 365 Office 5.
Please bring back pasta and wine.
No salami, they'll steal it.
I'll probably come back with it, but you won't be able to see it except on my body.
Can't get that. Yeah. Supposedly it's so much better than what we have here.
Well, someone explained to me that
it is.
Although they use sulfites are naturally occurring in wine, because they don't have to ship it across the Atlantic, they just don't use as much. So it doesn't give you the headaches or anything, but anything like that.
So it's not just me.
No.
Okay, I don't have anything else, Paul. No, a motion to adjourn?
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Adjourn, 8:22. Thank you very much.